You're listening to the audio production of The Ultimate Guide to Great Mentorship, 13 Rules to Making a True Impact by Scott Jeffrey Miller, published by HarperCollins Leadership and read by the author. Please note that you may download an accompanying PDF that provides enhanced materials for this audiobook. To download the PDF, please visit harperfocusaudio.com.
Introduction. When HarperCollins Leadership first approached me about authoring a book on mentoring, I was still coalescing the vision for the 10-year, 10-volume series I'm writing titled Master Mentors, 30 Transformative Insights from Our Greatest Minds. I just finished launching volumes 1 and 2 and had made appearances on more than 200 podcasts, television shows, and radio programs as part of the book series launch and ongoing marketing campaign. And the common questions nearly every host and interviewer wanted me to address were often less about the individual mentors I'd featured in the first books and more about the actual process of mentoring. How to select one, how to become one, what to do and not to do on both sides, what mentors get right and wrong, and how to recover when conversations don't go as planned. I was frequently asked if mentoring was still relevant in a post-pandemic and increasingly hybrid and virtual work world. When does it go sideways? How do mentors deal with unprepared and overly demanding mentees? The questions seemed endless and interesting, and I had an answer for all of them. Imagine that. So I went to work outlining and codifying my point of view on mentoring, recognizing that other books have been written about this topic and by well-qualified authors, including the leadership icon John Maxwell, whom I've interviewed for the On Leadership with Scott Miller podcast. As I built my book architecture and drew on my own 3 decades as a mentor and mentee, I quickly realized I wanted to focus on the many roles mentors play, and specifically on how they differ based on the mentee-mentor dynamic. I identified 15 roles I thought were important, and when I presented them to my early group of advisors who read all of my pre-released manuscripts, most of them about passed out. They told me 15 was a death march, and I absolutely had to narrow the list to a more manageable number, like 8 or at the most 10, but never 15. I agreed. I set about clarifying my thoughts on each role and determining which ones were duplicates and could be eliminated or collapsed into others. But a funny thing happened on the way to winnowing the roles. They took on a clearer distinction and seemed worthy of inclusion. With some tightening, I landed on 13. Admittedly, even that was a little painful. Of course, even then, some roles may seem similar to each other, but with only nuanced differences. Others will feel distinctly different in their goals and application. I think your own point of view on the differences and similarities will come to life once you meet with individual mentees and experience their own unique personalities, fears, joys, and perspectives. My intent is to give you a roadmap for all the roles I think you'll be asked to play, consciously and even unconsciously, as you mentor. I think maybe later after reading this book, you might say to yourself, oh, now I see some nuances between this role and the other that Scott was talking about. At least that's my hope. So my advance apologies for intentionally violating the magical number 7 rule. I think it's more important you build your awareness about all 13 roles, even if your brain can't recall the list as easily as if there were fewer. That's why we have books. Maybe I'm insolent, or maybe I'm onto something valuable for each of you. I'm sure you'll let me know in your Amazon reviews. I read them all after a few glasses of champagne. Surprisingly, I don't care as much after the cork pops. Here are some quick tips on how to make the most of this book. First, the book was written nearly exclusively for the mentor, not the mentee. I don't think there are any secrets mentees can't know about, but I'd caution you about how much you choose to share what you're reading, as you want your adoption of the roles to be natural and aligned with your own style and never feel contrived, awkward, or obvious that you're moving from one to another. Second, the 13 rules are not all going to happen in every mentoring relationship. And they certainly don't happen all at the same time or in any specific sequence per se, with a couple of minor exceptions. My intent is to equip you with the knowledge, awareness, preparedness, and enhanced skills, and even scripts, so as topics and circumstances arise, you can identify a role that's relevant and worth adopting at any moment. Third, I focus on each role in two sections: chapters for reading and absorbing, and captures for reflection and note-taking. My recommendation is to listen to the chapter and highlight anything you think would be valuable for where you are in your own mentoring journey, including insights, phrases, questions, or statements you might like to integrate into your own conversations. Each chapter aligns to a role and is organized into similar parts. First, a description of the role, the goal, upsides, downsides, skills, a narrative aligned to each of those identified skills, and then finally, a short video illustration, that's the QR code found in the accompanying PDF of me, the author, highlighting key insights and sharing bonus material in a short video. Then after you've listened to the role-specific chapter, use the additional tools found in the accompanying PDF for taking notes before, during, and after your mentoring sessions or as pull-through of any insights you'd like to remember to draw upon later. Finally, visit greatmentorship.com for more tools and resources to help perfect your mentoring contribution. Here are some potential watchouts to consider as you're reading about each of the roles. First, I use a lot, I mean a lot of metaphors. I hope you like them and find them valuable. If you don't, and some of you won't, keep listening and leave them behind. I certainly don't want you getting hijacked by what you might think is a distracting metaphor. It's how I speak and thus how I write. At least you know you're getting an authentic Scott Jeffrey Miller experience. Next, you'll likely find some of the roles very similar to each other and may even struggle to see substantive differences. In some cases, they are subtle, and the differences might come to you later, even after listening and hopefully in the midst of your own mentoring sessions. Don't get hung up on similarities. Keep listening to the next chapter or role if you're spending too much time trying to differentiate. Lastly, at the end of the book, what I hope you take away is an awareness of when you choose to function in a particular role. So make them your own. Maybe you decide to choose 3 or 4 roles and stick with them for much or most or even all of your mentoring time. That's your call. Don't get bogged down in a quandary of, am I in this role or that role? Just the awareness that there are roles, and some of them will come more naturally to you and be more valuable to your mentee, is mission accomplished. There also is an optional card deck and accompanying journal available at greatmentorship.com that have been designed as tools to help bring these roles to life in an organized and thoughtful way across your unique mentorship journey. Your potential for positively influencing your mentee is incalculable. In fact, you will never know the full extent of your impact because your mentee doesn't always fully appreciate or even understand it themselves. That's okay. Just trust that your investment is likely changing a life, maybe even your own. Role 1, the revealer. The revealer works like a paleontologist, delicately brushing away the metaphorical dust and debris to reveal their mentee's passions, talents, fears, and goals. The revealer delicately uncovers what's just beneath the surface and/or digs deeper as appropriate. In essence, they work to uncover so others can discover, all while remaining hyper-aware of their own footprints, known as personalities, in the metaphorical sand. The goal, to lead the mentee's awareness, progress, and growth through precise exploration and discovery, and along the way ensure their own style and approach doesn't overwhelm or distract. The upside when the revealer role is employed well. First, it surfaces important facts and feelings that can help or hinder personal effectiveness and engagement. Second, provides a framework for a mentor to lean into their own stylistic strengths or work through and around weaknesses. And finally, helps a mentee feel safe and appropriately vulnerable so they can become comfortable with being uncomfortable. The downside when the revealer role is abdicated. A mentee can easily shut down, feel overwhelmed, or become intimidated by a heavy-handed mentoring approach. As a result, they can often pull back, obfuscate, or even abandon the relationship altogether. Key revealer skills. Know the dig site, what the mentee is trying to accomplish in the environment in which they are trying to accomplish it. Employ patience and deliberate thinking. Remain hyper-aware of your own footprints, known as your default personality style, and explore with an inquisitive and gentle approach. Know the dig site, what the mentee is trying to accomplish and the environment in which they are trying to accomplish it. In many facets as a mentor, you're leading an excavation, uncovering, revealing, retrieving. Metaphorically, you're bringing to life what may be buried beneath the surface as it relates to the passions and goals of your mentee. Enter the paleontologist-like revealer. The revealer doesn't helicopter into a site and whip up a cloud of dust and debris. Rather, they understand that a mentee's goals, like a dig site, can be easily trodden over, disrupted, or even demolished. The revealer carefully enters the space with their tools, expertise, and an inquisitive nature in tow. They're discreet and delicate about both where they're stepping and why. They certainly don't use jackhammers and backhoes, at least not early on. The revealer understands that a mentee is often part of an existing team, complete with norms, cultural expectations, and unique faux pas from each member. The revealer, as paleontologist, isn't interested in blowing up or changing the site in which their mentee works. They are a precise excavator focused on going deep with their mentee. The revealer is always aware that the environment matters. For example, if you're mentoring someone in your organization whose, quote, dig site is contemplating an upward career trajectory, they may or may not know if they're even in the right culture for them to succeed. If they're more entrepreneurial-minded, they may be confused as to whether they should secure a small business loan for future seed funds or, more boldly, approach a venture capitalist or angel investor. Everyone's dig site is going to be different. It's important when you're in the role of the revealer that you're hyper-aware of your own prejudices, expectations, preconceived eventualities, and so on. As a mentor, your collective life experiences often provide valuable shortcuts for you to make snap decisions about how to move forward. And that is a dangerous competency you'll be tempted to employ. Proceed with enormous caution and do not assume you know what you're uncovering. Even paleontologists sometimes don't know whether the first bone is going to be from a brontosaurus, a pterodactyl, or even an undiscovered species. Repeat, you don't announce, "Eureka, we found a T-Rex," with mere millimeters of the fossil exposed. You shouldn't presuppose anything. Later, maybe in the process, but not in the beginning, revealers always learn the lay of the land first. Employ patience and deliberate thinking. Revealers are patient and deliberate people, or summon these characteristics if they don't come naturally. They don't always know what they're going to uncover, and so they remain open to what might reveal itself. They may have an inkling, but they're careful not to let assumptions dictate their process or discoveries. They seek understanding and discovery through delicate brushstrokes, not hammer blows. Depending on the mentee's personality, socioeconomic background, education, goals, confidence, fears, and so on, you may need to brush longer and more delicately than you otherwise would in your own career or life, or with your spouse or partner, or even children.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.